Welcome to Burnt Factory United Methodist Church. Grace and peace to you. I am Pastor Steve Malister, and we are so glad that you have chosen to join us for worship today through our live streaming service. It is our prayer and our hope today that you will experience the love of Jesus Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the truth of the gospel message. Friends, no matter what is going on in your life today, no matter what challenges and struggles you may be facing, we want you to know that God loves you. And may God's peace be with you this day. No matter what you may be enduring, never forget that God loves you. Good morning, friends. It is wonderful to invite you into our worship service once again. And if you can see this beautiful offering in front of us, what a outpouring of support. I am so thankful that you have responded to this wonderful plea for the William and Henry Evans home. We have got just an abundance of gifts that have been given. And I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for continuing to respond to the call to serve our community with love. I know that they will appreciate immensely this wonderful gift. And I want to take time, if I could, would you bow with me and let's consecrate these wonderful gifts to the glory of God. Almighty and most merciful Lord, we thank you for the generosity of this faith community. We thank you for your Holy Spirit guiding and directing us. What a wonderful bounty of gifts that we will bestow upon this most worthy organization. We thank you for the generosity and for the love in which that all has been given. And we consecrate it now for your glory, that your love will be shared with others. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, I want to invite Rob to come forward at this point and to share our opening prayer, our call to worship with you this morning. Rob?
Thank you, Steve. Good morning. It is great to be here. It is always good to worship our Lord and our Savior, God Almighty. Do you feel like worshiping God this morning? If you see this outpouring Steve has just consecrated to God's glory, know that the church is vital, that we are giving back, and that is part of what you are doing in the community of Burnt Factory, and we thank you, and may God receive the glory. Thank you for the blessings. We also have the wonderful joy of knowing that Saturday, the youth went out and they gave out over 150 gallons of milk to some of the local motels, as well as other supplies. Many are struggling, and those that have blessings, may we share them. So we want to thank Carrie for her leadership for that, and for all the volunteers and the youth, especially, to go and be the hands and feet of Christ. May we give thanks to Him and invite Him here to be in our holy places. May we pray. To you, Almighty, we give honor and glory, for you are worthy. We welcome you to lead us in our time of worship, to be present in our holy places and transform our hearts. In these confusing and stressful times, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Precious Lord, you make the difference in our lives. We offer these prayers in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen indeed. My friends, will you join with me as we proclaim our faith with the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, who was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. It's children's time. Oh, and I know Carrie has a great lesson here this morning. But to introduce us, we have the famous Sutphin Family Singers. That is with, of course, Clayton, Audrey, Lillian, and we know Brooks is in there somewhere. And you will see that this is going to be a Tim and Ashley production. So welcome and enjoy children's time.
Two, three.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes.
You guys kind of caught me eating. Excuse me. I'm trying to eat my Chick-fil-A. You know, love me some Chick-fil-A while I'm in my office working. You know how that goes. Love it. Well, you know what? I really wish I could share my food with you. Although, I only have a few nuggets and a few fries and only have one drink. But I so wish I could share it with all of you. Wouldn't it be nice if we could all sit around together and share Chick-fil-A? Ooh, that would be so good. That reminds me of a story. You know, Jesus was heading up to a quiet place to pray with his disciples. And as he took the boat and he went across and he thought, oh, we'll go over here. We'll go far away so we can just have some time, some peace and quiet to ourselves. And when they get over to the other side of the shore, they see crowds and crowds of people. And Jesus being Jesus, because he is an amazing man, loved his people, loved God. His job was to minister to these people. And that's exactly what he did. So he got the people around, he sat together and told them many, many, many parables, many stories that people needed to hear. He encouraged them and discipled them and loved on them. But as the sun started to go down, you know, there were people all over that were starting to get hungry and they had been there all day long. Now, knowing Jesus, as we do, Jesus was about to do something totally and super awesome. He told his disciples to feed them. Well, I can tell you right now, if I'd have been one of those disciples that had been like, I've got 12 Chick-fil-A chicken nuggets and I've got a few thing of fries and one drink. How am I going to feed 5,000 men plus women and children? There's no way. It's not like the local Chick-fil-A down the street that I can just take everybody to or go down there and I need 5,000 orders of number one, please. And I need 5,000 orders of 12 count nuggets. Wasn't going to work. But Jesus, being Jesus, he took a little boy's lunch who said, here, this is all I have to give, but I'm going to give it to you, Jesus. Jesus saw that little boy's heart and he said, okay. And he raised that up to God and he gave thanks for that little boy's food. I wish I could have been there just to see Jesus pray to God. Oh, what an amazing, amazing moment of Holy Spirit and just worship and love. Wow. Can only picture it, right? So God does this amazing thing with this little boy's lunch. You know, just a few loaves of bread and a couple of fish. Little tiny fish, little barley loaves that just kind of would fall apart, but they were good enough to make a little sandwich out of, right? This little boy, it's all he had, but he was so in tune to what Jesus was seeing, was saying and hearing Jesus that he forgot to eat his lunch. And then he gives it to Jesus. And Jesus does this amazing thing. He tells the disciples, go get some baskets. And the disciples go get baskets. And they come back and here Jesus just keeps filling their baskets. And they keep going and they keep spreading this food everywhere. It just keeps multiplying. It just keeps going and going and going. And then everybody was fed with full bellies. Not just a snack, but they ate with full bellies. Now, that was a miracle. We don't know exactly how God did it. But the thing is God did it. And all because one little boy decided to share what he had with Jesus. So my friends, when I tell you this story, I tell you not at the weight or the glory of the miracle, but I want you to know that everything that you have, you can share with others. It only takes a small thing. Maybe sending a card to a friend. Maybe sending a note to a teacher that you're going to have this year. We know this year, the school year might be a little crazy, but people are going to need you. They're going to need you to be calm because you have Jesus in your heart. They're going to need you to show the world who Jesus is during this time. Share what you have with others because that's what Jesus calls us to do. We're so blessed to have Jesus in our lives. We're so blessed to have Jesus in our hearts and be filled with love. So my friends, take Jesus and share him with everyone that you know. Talk about him. Send people cards, letters, pictures. Send them an email. Your mom and dad will help you. This is what I'm asking you to do. Because people need to hear from you. They need to hear you're thinking about them. Because that's what Jesus is asking us to do. Is love our neighbors and share what we have with others. Let's pray. Dear Father, just as Jesus used the lunch of a small boy to feed 5,000 plus people, we pray that you will use these boys and girls, God, to bless everyone that they meet each and every day. We thank you for sending Jesus into our hearts and into this world to show us what real love really is. Help us to show love and caring toward others who need to hear from us so bad in this world today. It is all this we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's kids said, Amen! Well, it was good to chat with you for a few minutes, but I'm going to get back to reading my Bible and chomping on my Chick-fil-A. Love you, and God bless.
When he told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough. Stop you in your steps. Fear, he is a liar. He will rob your rest, steal your happiness, cast your fear in the fire. Cause fear, he is a liar. Trouble, you'll forever be alone. When he told you you should run away, you'll never find a home. When he told you you were dirty and that you should be ashamed. When he told you you could be the one that grace could never change. Oh, let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I fear. Let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I fear. Let your fire fall and cast down all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I feel. Well, let your fire fall and cast down all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I need. Oh, fear is a liar. He will take your breath, stop you in your steps. Fear is a liar. He will rob your rest, steal your
Well, once again, I want to thank everyone for sharing their gifts and graces as we continue to provide this service for you until we can come together again. And we are truly hoping that that will be fairly soon. And you'll be hearing more about that at the end of the service here this morning. Let me share with you our scripture passage today. We are continuing in Matthew's gospel. In the 14th chapter, I'll be reading verses 13 through 21. Hear now the word of God as it comes to us through Matthew. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, and he healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so that they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." And Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and he broke the loaves. And then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. And the number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the word of God for the people of God. Will you pray with me? Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for your word to us today. We thank you for the gospel writers. We thank you for the living word, your son, Jesus Christ, and his teachings. We pray, Father, you would open our eyes, open our ears to hear God's word this day, and that my words would be yours. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Charles Swindell tells a very funny story about a 7-year-old little boy named Danny who came bursting out of his Sunday school class one morning with great excitement. He was looking everywhere for his mom and dad, and finally, after a quick search, he grabbed his daddy by the leg, and he said, "Man, oh man, Dad, the story of Moses and all of those people crossing the Red Sea was really great." His father looked down and smiled and asked the boy, "Well, tell me all about it." "Well," he said, "Dad, the Israelites got out of Egypt. But Pharaoh and his army chased after them. So the Hebrews ran as fast as they could till they got to the Red Sea. The Egyptian army was getting closer and closer and closer. So Moses got out his walkie-talkie and he told the Israeli Air Force to bomb the Egyptians. And while that was happening, the Israeli Navy built a pontoon bridge so that the people could cross over. And they made it to safety. Well, by now, his dad was really shocked. He said, "Is that what they taught you in Sunday school?" The little boy said, "Well, no, not exactly, Dad. But if I told you the way they told it, you'd never believe it. You'd never believe it, Dad." With childlike innocence, this young boy put his finger on the challenge of some Bible passages, including this one this morning. When we read the story of feeding the 5,000, and actually it was a good many more than that, we tend to focus our attention on this question: did it really happen? Did it really happen? And we tend to be skeptical. We tend to try and explain it in ways that we can accept it according to our modern sensibilities. Now, some questions I suggest that we should be asking ourselves is not, did it really happen, or is it really true, but rather, do we believe Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of prophecy? Do we believe that this itinerant preacher and healer is truly the Son of the living God, the Messiah, the Anointed One, our Savior? And if we believe this, then do we believe this Jesus does in fact have the power and authority to perform miracles? Did it really happen? Yes, it did. And all four gospel writers include it in their gospel writings. All four of them, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all include this wonderful miracle story in the good news. Now the question is, what can we learn from this story today? What truth can we glean? What can we apply to our lives today about this wonderful story? I believe that there are three truths. There are many more, but I want to share with you at least three truths this morning. And the first one is one that our staff and myself, we talk about all the time. The first truth is that ministry is not convenient. Now, in the United Methodist Church, we are all ministers. We are all ministers, therefore, we all have a ministry. And ministry is not convenient. The scripture today, I want to go back, begins by saying this. When Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. Why did Jesus want to get away from everybody? What was it that he heard? What disturbed him so much that he wanted to get away and have some time alone? If we go back to the beginning of the 14th chapter of Matthew, I'll tell you what he had heard. He had heard that his friend, his cousin, his colleague in the faith, he had heard that John, the one who had baptized him so that all righteousness could be fulfilled, was executed. Was beheaded, was used and abused as a political means to an end because he had spoken the truth and had offended those who needed offending. His life, his earthly life, in the end, would have no more value than being subjected to the whims of a spoiled girl, her jealous, evil mother, and a terrible king. And like any of us, who are grieving or are upset about death or tragic events, Jesus, the human Jesus, wanted to get away for a while. He wanted to withdraw, to find a quiet place of rest and peace where he could commune with the Father, where he could take a break from his calling, where he could find some solitude and grieve and mourn for this wonderful man of God, John the Baptist. But crowds were still forming. He couldn't even get away in a boat. They had followed him along the seashore. The crowds kept coming, yearning, calling for him to come back ashore. And finally, Jesus comes back to a deserted place, but certainly not a place of solitude. He is overwhelmed by the crowds. And because they have followed him to this deserted place, they had placed themselves in a position where they would have no access to food. Many were sick, many were hungry. And the scripture says Jesus had compassion on them. He started healing them. Jesus didn't have time to grieve. Because ministry and the opportunity to do ministry, to be in ministry, does not occur on our timetable. Ministry opportunities do not bow down to our schedules. Ministry happens or doesn't happen, not dependent on our needs, but on the needs of others. And God places opportunities in front of each and every one of us every day, and we can choose to act or to not act. We can choose to be Christ to others in their need. We can be compassionate to others when they need us, or we can choose to wait until it is convenient. A choice that grieves the Holy Spirit and wastes an opportunity to be the face of Christ to those in need. Ministry is not convenient. Jesus would have to find his quiet time and his place of solitude and rest and peace later. He would have to mourn later. He would have to find a way to grieve for his friend John at another time. And yes, it's not fair. It's not about great timing. Yes, and even Jesus needed a break. But he recognized the need of others above his need. And the scripture says he had compassion on them. Ministry happens all the times. All the time. It happens at night. It happens in the daytime, early in the morning, when you're getting ready to go to bed. Ministry happens with all kinds of people. It happens in the church and outside of the church. It happens on the streets and houses and families and cars at the workplace. It happens when we least expect it and with whom we least expect it with. And no matter what is happening in our lives, we who claim Jesus are still to be ministers of the gospel, sharing whatever God has granted unto us with our gifts and graces. And it is very seldom convenient. Now, the second truth I want to share with you this morning is involving collaboration. When ministry opportunities arise, when the Holy Spirit leads us, we must understand that we are never alone in our ministry. We can't perform miracles, but God working with us and through us, we can still make a difference for the kingdom and the glory of God. In this story today, the disciples were stressed out. What are we going to do? Please, Lord, this is not convenient. What are we going to do? Please send them away. It's getting late. The caterer didn't show up. McDonald's is closed. There's no Happy Meals available. Send them away, for goodness sake. All we have is 2 measly fish and 5 loaves of bread. Send them away so that they may be able to find something to eat. What does Jesus say? He says, you give them something to eat. Think about that. There's 5,000 plus. You give them something to eat. Jesus is suggesting that we must act in obedience to His word and in collaboration with His leading, for He is the Lord who has authority and who has power and who has providence and who has promise. We are to act in conjunction with our Lord to do things we think are impossible. We are to be willing to serve always and anywhere and at any time. Why? Because as followers of Christ Jesus, we are called to serve and to not be served. And sometimes we are called to be cooks and waiters and waitresses in the kingdom for the glory of God. We are called to give them something to eat. Why? Because there are always going to be those who are hungry. And I'm not talking about just physical hunger. I'm talking about spiritual hunger. And here we are 2,000 years from when Christ taught this lesson and walked this earth, and we are still tearing each other to pieces. Still angry. Still wanting it all to go away instead of looking at it as opportunities for ministries. We have food as Christians. Spiritual food that is in great need now. What gifts have God granted to you? And are you using those gifts? And do you still believe in miracles? Do you believe that the Holy Spirit will empower and equip you to go and to give them something to eat? We have enough food to feed everyone in the world. Physical food, and yes, even to have some left over. God has given us a means and the technology to feed anyone who may be hungry. But God also gave us His only begotten Son. God gave us Jesus Christ and the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit. The best food of all is the food that comes down to us from heaven. And the promises of God as found and realized in Jesus, who is the bread of life itself. We have the bread of life, the Spirit of Jesus living within ourselves. There are many people who say miracles don't happen anymore, if they ever did. There will be those who will always have doubt, those who will always concentrate more on facts than faith and on happenstance instead of hope. There's always going to be those who will want to squash dreams. But don't we know better than to underestimate God? Don't we? Jesus said, you give them something to eat. In other words, Jesus is saying, I'll do my part. I want you to do your part. So this second truth is about being collaborators with the Holy Spirit. Partners with Jesus Christ our Lord for the advancement of His kingdom here on this old earth. So the third truth, it leads us to this. We need to trust God. We need to trust God. If God, who spoke the world and everything in it into existence, if God, who made us in His image and blew life into lifeless dust, if God, who placed the stars in the sky and causes the rain to fall and the sun to shine and the planets to turn on their axis, if God, who scooped out the valleys and raised up the mountains, if God, who changed the world with 12 of the most unqualified and unlikely bunch of misfits the world had ever seen, if God, who worked His purposes and His plans through people like Moses, who couldn't speak clearly and who had committed murder earlier in his life, if God, who continued to call people like me and you, who are broken and imperfect, called people like Jacob and David and Samson and Rahab the prostitute and Peter and Matthew and Mary Magdalene and Paul, and the list goes on and on and on. If God, who through the resurrection of His Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, abolished death forever and released us, His children, from slavery to sin, if God, who did all of this and so much more on our behalf and for our redemption and for our atonement and for our forgiveness and for our salvation, if God did all of this, can we not trust Him? Is Jesus the Son of God, the Messiah, the miracle worker, our Savior? Can we trust in His promises or not? Jesus took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, He blessed them, and breaking the loaves, He gave them to His disciples, and the disciples gave to the multitudes, and they all ate. They all had plenty to eat. Somehow, someway, it happened. Matthew gives us no explanation, no details, no plan as to how it occurred. We don't know the specifics of the miracle, and it doesn't matter. What difference does it make how God works? If God wants to multiply loaves and bread, that's wonderful. If God wants to open up people's hearts and cause them to share in abundance out of their possessions, then that's great too. The point is this, and this is the miracle, this is the main truth. The point, no matter how it happened, is this: people were fed. Not because of anything they did or earned or deserved, but because Jesus had compassion on them. He loved them. They were fed because that is what Jesus came to do. 2 fish and 5 loaves in our hands will provide a meal, but 2 fish and 5 loaves in the hands of Jesus will provide enough for everyone, and then some. Jesus gives us His mission statement in Luke's gospel in the 4th chapter. And it is based upon the same compassion in which Jesus initiated this miracle this morning. The 4th chapter of Luke says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me," Jesus said, "because He has anointed me first to proclaim good news to the poor. Secondly, He has sent me to proclaim freedom for prisoners. Thirdly, recovery of sight for the blind, and fourth, to set the oppressed free." Are we to do any less? Let me close by saying this. The ministry of compassion. The ministry of compassion is never better understood than in the 18th verse, where Jesus, when offered the 2 fish and the 5 loaves, doesn't say, "Oh, that'll never be enough. That'll never work. It'll never be the same again. Go get me some more. That will never do." What does Jesus say? "Bring them here to me." Jesus always says, "Bring them to me." And I'm not talking about bread and fish. "Bring me your children. Suffer them not to come to me. Bring me the blind and the deaf. Bring me the lame. Bring me those who mourn. Bring me those who are suffering. Bring me those who have made mistakes. Bring me those who are broken. Bring me those who have no one in their lives. Bring me the lonely, the addicted. Bring me the despondent and the hopeless. Bring me the lepers, and bring me the hungry, and bring me the lost, and bring me the ones that our society has forgotten and judged. Bring me the scared girl that had to run away from home. Bring me the abused woman who had to get out of her house. Bring me all of those who have been battered and beat up by life. Bring me the COVID patients. Bring me those that have been imprisoned and forgotten. Bring me the ones who are in deep grief because they can't even be with their loved ones in the hospital. Bring me the mentally ill. Bring me the orphans and the widows. Bring me the ones who are now more isolated than ever. Bring me the ones who seem to be so angry all the time about everything. Bring me the ones who nobody else wants. Jesus says, bring them to me and I will feed them. To Jesus Christ, there is not one life that is not important to Him. He comes to save all who would seek Him. He comes to have compassion on all, even when they don't seek Him. And when things look bleak, when we believe we can't go on anymore, when the frustration is just getting the best of us, when we are starving for life and for community and for the sacraments and for worship and for a hug, for closure, for healing, Jesus says, bring them all to me. Bring them to me. It may not look like enough, but God will make a way. It may not look like enough, but God says, my grace is sufficient. It may not look like enough, just a couple loaves of bread and a couple fish. But guess what? Nothing will separate you from my love. It may not look like enough right now, but I'm still the resurrection and the life. It may not look like enough right now, but I'm the bread of life, and I will always have enough and be enough, and I will never forsake you, and I will never leave you. It may not look like enough right now, but my word is a lamp unto your feet. It may not look like enough right now, but God says this, do not be afraid. I will save you. I have called you by name. You are mine. And when you pass through deep waters, I will be with you. Your troubles will not overwhelm you. When you pass through the fire, you will not be burned. Trust in me, God says. Blessed are those who, when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of things against you because of me, rejoice and be glad. Great is your reward in heaven. Amen. Did miracles happen? Do they still happen? You had better believe it. And there is no better miracle than the truth and the fact that while we were yet sinners, Jesus died for us. Ministry is not convenient. We are never alone in ministry. And we can trust God. Friends, you can take that to the bank. Praise be to God. And let those who have eyes to see and ears to hear and a heart to feel, may you experience the truth of the Word of God this day. Let us pray. Almighty and loving and most of all compassionate God, how can we thank you enough for the miracle of your love for us and for the miracle of your grace poured out upon us? We desperately need that grace now. We pray that you would help us reclaim the love we have for each other, to trust in your grace and love. Help us to know that miracles still happen. We fall on our feet, on our knees before you this day. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, I want to take a moment to just share with you that the question that seems to be on everyone's mind right now is, when are we coming back to church? When are we re-entering the church? So I want to share with you that you will be receiving a letter over email and Facebook and all the different ways that we get it to you. It will be in the newsletter coming out next week. You'll be receiving a letter soon that's going to tell you what we are thinking and some of the plans that we have been working hard to facilitate re-entrance into in-person worship. There will be a lot of details, and I'm not going to go into them now. I'm hoping, and we'll let you know for sure, but I'm hoping that this Thursday evening at 7 o'clock, you will be able to tune in and hear the specifics of this letter. You will have it in front of you as well. It is very important for us to educate everyone, and we do believe that the time is coming close. Unfortunately, we have not entered into our denominational stage 3. Therefore, we are trying to come back in under stage 2 restrictions. And we believe we can do that safely. And certainly, we want no one to try to even come in at all if they are not comfortable. We certainly want to continue our streaming services. So anyway, you'll be getting information. We will be educating everyone as to what we believe needs to happen. The other thing I want to share with you today is that my office is always open. My phone is always on. If there are questions about the reasons we're doing what we're doing, if there are questions about our outreach ministries, if there are questions about the bishop's response, if there are questions about my leadership, my door is always open. My cell phone is always turned on. I want to encourage you, if you have questions, if you have issues, please come and talk. That's what we're here for. That's what I'm here for. And I do appreciate the way that you continue to be so generous and so faithful. And these are trying and stressful and difficult times for all of us. And I cherish your prayers. And I'm thankful for your generosity and for your faithfulness. So continue to pray as we all discern what is best and what is safe. I thank you for your continued prayers and support. And at this time, let us bow our heads wherever you may be, and let us conclude our service in prayer. Most merciful God, we live in frustrating times. We live in times where we just find it hard to trust anymore. We live in times that are discouraging, and yet we know that your hand is upon us. We know that no weapon formed against us will prevail. We know that one day all of this will be over. There's stress in our families and in our churches and in the way we communicate with one another. There's stresses in our society now and in our culture. Everywhere we turn, the evil one is sowing seeds of doubt and despair and hopelessness. But we are God's people. We need to claim Jesus Christ and His grace and His compassion. And we need to practice kindness and pour out grace upon each other. One day this will all be over. One day we will gather as we had. We lift up our prayers this day for those who have lost loved ones, who have been unable to have services, have been unable to be with those that are ill and in the hospital. We ask you to be with those that are facing surgeries that have to be dropped off at the hospital door. We know these things must take place. We pray that you would calm the anger that seems to be overtaking so many. We pray for your grace, for your forgiveness, for your redemption. We thank you for your love for us this day. We thank you for the miracles that come when we just can't see them. But they're there. I pray you would open our eyes. We pray now together our family prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, friends, wherever you may this be a glorious Sabbath for you, and may you have a day to rest and to have peace. And may you have the love of God instilled upon your spirit. May you have the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ inside your very heart, and may you be empowered and equipped by the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. When my strength
is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the your home.